Just let us know if you don't want to be on the list, but otherwise we are going to distribute that sometime after the conference so that you can stay in touch with one another. The networking system that we create is what is going to change the course of civilization. So it's very important, our work. And of course, as you all know, one of the most important events that we have at the conference is the Afterglow. Those of you who made it last night know what a wonderful time it is, but just so everyone understands, someone asked, well, who's in charge of the Afterglow? It is democracy. Everyone who's there is who runs it. Obviously there's a lot of great generosity and sharing, but you are responsible to bring your own stuff if you can, and that's what we ask you to do, so whatever beverage or other items you want to enjoy in there, if you can bring them, but don't be afraid to bring a little extra for those who need to, like me. All right, so, but there, the place to get beer and wine, the address is on that little handout of the Welcome to Western Pennsylvania handout, but it's the Pennsylvania Wine and Spirits is the place to get spirits, and right across from that is the beer store. They don't sell beer and wine in the same establishments. It's an interesting law here in Pennsylvania. Yes, Chesterton says the Puritans have done great damage. We're still living under their heritage here. Some of you have noticed the wonderful art in the back there, right behind John Medina and his hat there. John waves, so everyone, yeah, so he's not the work of art, but behind him is the, and we are going to be auctioning off those pieces at the banquet. There is an original lino cut of Chesterton with the wonderful hair, that's the one in the middle, and a lithograph on the right side, both by an artist from Louisiana. And then the original cover art for Jousting with the Devil, Father Wilde's book, is also there, a pencil drawing. All of those will be auctioned off at the banquet. And we also just found out we have another item, another work of art to auction off. Some of you have seen it at Nancy Brown's table. Nancy's husband, Mike, is an artist who has done something really, it's just a wonderful, unique art form of making three-dimensional photographs. And he has created the world's first three-dimensional photograph of G.K. Chesterton. And it's on display, the large version of it's on display, but we're also going to be auctioning that off at the banquet. So please keep that in mind. It's a really wonderful, beautiful picture of Gilbert and Francis that you can walk right into the photograph there and be part of it. Or he walks out of it, however you take it. It's three-dimensional. It's not an illusion. It really is. It's three-dimensional. All right. Okay, it's an illusion. And speaking of drawings, we're going to have another kind of drawing at the banquet. The raffle type of drawing, but we can't call it raffle because the government controls that sort of thing. That's gambling. But this isn't gambling. This is just a drawing. So you put money in, and you get a chance of winning. Chance. Opportunity, not chance. Opportunity is what I'm saying. It's not gambling. It's no raffle involved. It's a drawing. So we have a signed limited edition of Chesterton's story that was published separately called The Sword of Wood. There were only 530 copies made. They're hand-bound. It's a beautiful edition, and it's autographed by G.K. Chesterton. Now, it's a great story because we had acquired this book, and we were going to auction it. Have a drawing for it, opportunity to win it. Someone came to the conference and said, he saw that, goes, I have a signed edition of The Sword of Wood that I was going to come and donate to you so that you could have a drawing for it. And we said, well, we already are going to do that. And so he's going to donate his copy instead. And then the one we acquired, we'll use some other year for something else. But it's just great. So it's 100% profit for us. So whatever that goes, it's good. But I want to thank Andrew Watson for donating that. That's a great question. Okay. That's it. Who here went on the pilgrimage to Rome with us back in 3 years ago? 4 years ago. Three. There are, see who they are there? And Jinx, where's Jinx and Terry? They're not here. Jinx and Terry are here too. There she walked. She was standing up, of course, that's why I couldn't see her. All right, okay. All right, good. So at least six or seven of you are here from the Rome Conference. Well, and we've got to do a picture, because this, obviously, is Sue Pilon's husband. And Sue was on the pilgrimage with us, so we're going to get together. We'll announce and get it. In fact, right after the conclusion of the talk, let's all of us get up here and get a picture, okay, with Mark. Because Mark's wife came on that pilgrimage with us. She had contacted me and said, I want to give a special gift. It was going to be a birthday gift, or what was it going to be? A birthday gift to Mark. I'm going to send him on the pilgrimage with you to Rome. I said, oh, that's great. And then after some cajoling, I said, Sue, you need to come too. And so she said, okay, I'll come too. It's great. And then Mark couldn't come. So the gift she was going to give to Mark, because he's got some excuse. Yeah, we changed the date so that it would magically coincide with the installation of Pope Francis. Yeah, we did change it. It was originally going to be in November.
November, my birthday.
We changed it your birthday's in November. So we changed it from November to March, and we went go in March, and we just happened to be there for an installation of a new pope. You know, that worked out. Yeah, that was good. But you missed it. I mean, did I ever tell you what a great pilgrimage you missed? Yeah. All right, I've known Mark for many years. He's one of the pillars of the Twin Cities Chesterton Society. He's a man of many talents. You'll be hearing him play the hammer dulcimer at the banquet. His actual career choice is not listed in the program because it's so embarrassing, so we're not even going to say what it is. But he
works for an investment banker.
He's just an amazingly well-read and articulate man, and for years we've talked about doing something about Flannery O'Connor at Chesterton. I've never seen it done. And he's very well-read in Flannery O'Connor. He actually has given this talk to the Twin Cities Chesterton Society as a warm-up for the conference, and it's just marvelous material. But Mark is such a great friend, and truly what he has, he describes himself as common man and father of eight is a great description. So please welcome my very good friend, Mark Pilon.
Thank you, Dale. Well, this is not my first experience in front of a Chesterton conference crowd. That was a dozen years ago. When Dale invited me to set him straight on how Chesterton was wrong about the French Revolution. The funny thing was, after I had fulfilled that request and set him straight, he ignored the wisdom of what I had to say. It's hard to understand, I know, but I don't think we should be too hard on Dale. How many of us would have invited public correction to begin with? Today, we are here to talk about Chesterton and Flannery O'Connor, the exuberant English giant and a socially reserved woman from Georgia. There are a few differences. He was prolific almost beyond measure. She produced two short novels and two collections of short stories of her fiction. He didn't spend much time in a piece once written. She constantly rewrote and revised. He thrived on the activity of Fleet Street and a public house. She had a dairy farm outside of Milledgeville, Georgia. far as we know, she never visited a pub, and he never owned a peacock. But he did feature a peacock in one of his stories. But in reading both authors over the years, I've been impressed by the many links between them, and those links have become the catalyst for this talk. To begin with, both were somewhat doted upon by their fathers. Coincidentally, both men named Edward, who worked in the real estate business. Brookhart Sewell said, Marie Louise Chesterton thought that Cecil was the cleverer of her two sons. Cecil was his mother's boy. Gilbert hardly mentions his mother at all in his autobiography, where he has a great deal to say about his father. One would guess that Marie Louise actually ran the household and Warwick Gardens in however haphazard a way, while Edward Chesterton pottered about and prosecuted his various hobbies. Regina O'Connor also ran the households in Savannah and Milledgeville. Her way was not haphazard. She was raising her daughter to be a lady, while her father has been described as being somewhat dreamy. Chesterton had great affection for his father's toy theater and the creative influence upon him. O'Connor did not have quite the same experience at home, but her father was a creative force, including slipping her notes signed King of Siam. She would engage in the game as Lord Flannery O'Connor. Young Chesterton and young O'Connor were both aloof in their own ways. The incredible absent-minded Chesterton was considered the most curious thing that ever was, in the words of fellow Junior Debating Society member Edward Ford. O'Connor's classmates recall her as self-reliant but remote. Her fascination with birds was observable at an early date. Her cousin recalled, I remember sitting on the front porch of Green Street and Flannery walking by with this little bantam on a leash. Listen to these two quotes from school friends. I can see him now, wrote Mr. Fordham. Very tall and lanky, striding untidily along Kensington High Street, smiling and sometimes scowling as he talked to himself, apparently oblivious of everything he passed. I can see her plodding along, said Charlotte Contreras. That's how she walked, with her head thrust forward and her hands behind her back, just clumping along, thinking about something, who knows what. In Brad Gooch's biography of O'Connor, there's a story that echoes for me the experience of some of Chesterton's teachers, who suddenly discover there's more to an apparently disengaged student than had met the eyes thus far. The setting is Margaret Abercrombie's home economics class at Peabody High School in Milledgeville, Georgia. The activity for the semester was soaring, and all the other girls busily sewed aprons or underwear for weeks on end, while O'Connor sat idly off to the side, not participating. Now, next Wednesday is the examination day for this course, Miss Abercrombie finally announced, a bit exasperated. All members who expect to receive a grade are to bring and display the various garments made during the quarter. I hardly see how you are going to get a whole outfit finished and ready, Mary Flannery. On the appointed day, Flannery arrived with her pet duckling and a whole outfit of underwear and clothes, beautifully sewn to fit the duck. The class and great glee all gathered around and helped dress the duck. Flannery passed the course. One strong link was drawing. Chesterton covered books, notebooks, apparently everything, with goblins, caricatures. O'Connor was similarly artistic, but not quite as prolific, and she was working primarily with chickens, drawn starting at the tail, according to her. The talent for caricature and cartoons was recognized as she became a cartoonist at Peabody High School and the Georgia State College for Women. She contributed articles and verse as well. Links to Ogden Nash and particularly James Thurber were evident. In fact, during her college years, she submitted items to the New Yorker, but was not successful. Edwin O'Connor died of lupus when Flannery was 15. An early sample revealing some aspects of the writer she would become It's found in a notebook from about 2 years later. The reality of death has come upon us. The consciousness of the power of God has broken our complacency like a bullet in the side. A sense of the dramatic, of the tragic, of the infinite has descended upon us, filling us with grief. But even above grief, wonder. Our plans were so beautifully laid out, ready to be carried to action. But with magnificent certainty, God laid them aside and said, "We have forgotten mine." 17. Even above grief, wonder. Journalism, written and drawn, was a prominent part of O'Connor's college years. Worth noting also was her experience with Professor Weisswanger. The professor was newly arrived from Manhattan and a thoroughly modern professor of philosophy. His class was a survey of modern philosophers, and later to Brad Gooch, he described a text titled The Making of the Modern Mind as, quote, an academic bestseller whose viewpoint and mine was secular humanism grounded in pragmatism. It took for granted that the Renaissance and the Age of Enlightenment set the Western mind free from the benightedness of medieval thought, from Thomas Aquinas, etc. Of that class, he said, Flannery sat in class, listened intently, took notes, and without her saying a word, it became clear that she didn't believe a word of what I was saying. Flannery did eventually speak as the class went on. In a later letter, referring to Weisswanger, she wrote, "He is the one that one day in a class says, the medieval church was polytheistic. I rise and say, the medieval church was not polytheistic. He fixes me very coldly. I am speaking, says he, as an anthropologist." By the time the class was finished, Weisswanger knew that her view was it was philosophical modernism that had blinded the Western mind. Already, according to him, she was very familiar with Aquinas and well-read in early philosophy. It was Weisswanger who urged her to apply to the graduate program at the University of Iowa to pursue a career in journalism. She did exactly that, but like Chesterton at the Slade School of Art, realizing that his vocation was in the written word, it was in journalism school that she realized that hers was in writing fiction. During her first semester at Iowa, she visited Paul Engel, director of the Iowa Writers' Workshop, the first MFA graduate writing program in the nation. Speaking to Engel, her accent was so strong, he asked her to repeat the question. Embarrassed, after he could still not understand her the second time, he handed her a pad. She wrote, "My name is Flannery O'Connor. I'm not a journalist, and I come to the writer's workshop." After seeing samples of her writing, she was readily admitted and began in earnest to become a writer of fiction. Her pursuit of that vocation led her from Iowa City to the Yaddo Artist Colony in Saratoga Springs, to New York City, and eventually to a room above the garage of the rural home of her adopted kin, Robert and Sally Fitzgerald, near Reading, Connecticut. It was while living there, with no intention of returning to a life in Georgia, that she was stricken with lupus at the age of 25. This forced a return to Milledgeville. Of this return, Sally Fitzgerald wrote, "The end of all her exploring, to paraphrase T.S. Eliot, was to arrive where she had started and know the place for the first time." Recognizing it as absolutely germane to the exercise of her particular vocation as a writer. Fitzgerald referenced Eliot, but it's easy to think of Chesterton when you read those lines. Whether O'Connor thought of Chesterton or not, she soon recognized that this place was absolutely germane to the exercise of her vocation. Chesterton said, "It is quite proper that a British diplomatist should seek the society Japanese generals if what he wants is Japanese generals, but if what he wants is people different from himself, he had much better stop at home and discuss religion with the housemaid. He went on to add more examples of our need to pay attention to our neighbor who, quote, comes to us clad in all the careless terrors of nature. He is as strange as the stars and reckless and indifferent as the rain. He is man, the most terrible of beasts. The fiction of Flannery O'Connor shows us our neighbor in just that light, and she recognized that her forced return to the place she had started and come to know for the first time was a gift from God. Speaking of her return to the South, she said, I thought it would be the end of any creation, any writing, any work for me. It was only the beginning. She also said, to call yourself a Georgia writer is certainly to declare a limitation, but one which, like all limitations, is a gateway to reality, is a great blessing, perhaps the greatest blessing a writer can have. As is well known here, Chesterton's breath was also staggering. His brother Cecil wrote in 1908, Mr. Chesterton's extraordinary versatility and copiousness of output is beyond question a danger to his permanent position in literature, if he means to have one. It is quite certain that he could do more than he has done if he could only make up his mind exactly what he wanted to do. O'Connor did make up her mind that she would write stories. And where Chesterton seemed unconcerned about his permanent position, she recognized that she would not likely have a large audience in her own time. I can wait 50 years, 100 years, to be understood, she said. She did give lectures which shed much light on her approach to fiction. She was prolific when it came to writing letters. And the book of her letters, The Habit of Being, is a treasure of humor and insight into her art. Brings me to another subject, the style of her prose. Chesterton was nothing if not expansive, to which might be added parenthetical. O'Connor was spare and compact. English ale versus southern whiskey. One example comes to mind. Chesterton spends a chapter of The Everlasting Man on the riddles of the gospel, demonstrating the audacity of the claims of Christ. It were better to rend our robes in a great cry of blasphemy by Caiaphas in the judgment, or to lay hold of the man as a maniac possessed of devils like the kinsmen in the crowd, rather than to stand stupidly debating fine shades of pantheism in the presence of so catastrophic a claim, he said, in part. In a letter of Betty Hester, O'Connor expressed the idea in her own unique style. As for Jesus being a realist, if he was not God, he was no realist, only a liar, and the crucifixion an act of justice. I think O'Connor's essays and letters are full of echoes of Chesterton. Let me give some examples. On the idea of fiction, Chesterton said, existence is a story and called the thrilling novel a purely Christian product. Christendom has excelled in the narrative romance exactly because it has insisted on the theological free will. O'Connor said, I don't think any genuine novelist is interested in a world of people who are strictly determined. Even if he writes about characters who are mostly unfree, it is the sudden free action, the open possibility which he knows is the only thing capable of illuminating the picture and giving it life. He also said, literature, like virtue, does not thrive in an atmosphere where the devil is not recognized as existing, both in himself and as a dramatic necessity for the writer. More on art and limits. Vocation is a limiting factor which extends even to the kind of material the writer is able to apprehend imaginatively. The Christian writer, particularly, will feel that whatever his initial gift is, it comes from God. And no matter how minor a gift, he will not be willing to destroy it by trying to use it outside its proper limits. How about this on changing the standard? One reason a great deal of our contemporary fiction is humorless is because so many of these writers are relativists and have to be continually justifying the actions of their characters on a sliding scale of values, on the test of a good religion. Either one is serious about salvation or one is not. And it is well to realize that the maximum amount of seriousness admits the maximum amount of comedy. Only if we are secure in our beliefs can we see the comical side of the universe. On True Adventure, picture me with my ground teeth stalking joy, fully armed too, as it is a highly dangerous quest. Education. The devil of educationism that possesses us is the kind that can be only cast out by prayer and fasting. Also, she mentioned, total non-retention has prevented my education from being a burden to me. A few from her fiction on modern materialism. The Christ-haunted would-be nihilist preacher Hazel Moats. A man with a good car don't need to be justified. Mm-hmm. On the snobbery of progress, the wandering one-armed handyman, Tom T. Shiflett, and the old woman whose homestead he approaches, Lucy Nell Crater. I told you could hang around and work for food, she said, if you don't mind sleeping in that car yonder. Why, listen, lady, he said with a grin of delight. The monks of old slept in their coffins. It wasn't as advanced as we are, she said. On passive amusement and the scientific society that discourages us from thinking about death, in Chesterton's words. In this story, an elderly Southern man, near death in fact, is stuck in his daughter's New York City apartment. She says to him, you need some inspiration and an outlet. If you would let me pull your chair around to look at the TV, you would quit thinking about morbid stuff, death and hell and judgment. My Lord. More passive amusements, the cinema. I persuaded my mother this week that she didn't want to go see the Ten Commandments. Told her she ought to read the book first anyway. And presented her with Exodus. Then to salve my guilty conscience, I went to see the Three Faces of Eve with her, as she don't like to go by herself. First time I'd been to the picture show in 2 or 3 years. It was not such a bad picture, but I ain't going again for another 3 years if I can possibly help. More modern materialism. I suppose gambling is not a virtue, but it almost seems like one in a society where there's such an exaggerated respect for the dollar. Golf. If you all get to drive balls into the dean of women, I see why you like to play golf. I can't imagine any other advantages to it. On the existence of truth. The truth does not change according to our ability to stomach it emotionally. In Orthodoxy, Chesterton said, mere optimism had reached its insane and appropriate termination. The theory that everything was good had become an orgy of everything that was bad. Similarly, O'Connor saw mere sentimentality leading to extreme cruelty. One of the tendencies of our age is to use the suffering of children to discredit the goodness of God. And once you have discredited his goodness, you're done with him. The Elmers, whom Hawthorne saw as a menace, have multiplied. Busy cutting down human imperfection, they are making headway also on the raw material of good. In this popular pity, we mark our gain in sensibility and our loss in vision. If other ages felt less, they saw more, even though they saw with the blind, prophetical, unsentimental eye of acceptance, which is to say, of faith. In the absence of this faith now, we govern by tenderness. It is a tenderness which long since cut off from the person of Christ, is wrapped in theory. Untenderness is detached from the source of tenderness. Its logical outcome is terror. It ends in the forced labor camps and the fumes of the gas chamber. And one more on the laws of nature. To see Christ as God and man is probably no more difficult today than it has always been, even if today there seem to be more reasons to doubt. For you, it may be a matter of not being able to accept what you call a suspension of the laws of flesh and the physical. But for my part, I think that when I know what the laws of the flesh and the physical really are, then I will know what God is. We know them as we see them, not as God sees them. For me, it is the virgin birth, the incarnation, the resurrection, which are the true laws of the flesh and the physical. Death, decay, destruction are the suspension of these laws. I'm always astonished at the emphasis the church puts on the body. It's not the soul, she says, that will rise, but the body glorified. I've always thought that purity was the most mysterious of virtues, but it occurs to me that it would never have entered the human consciousness to conceive of purity if we were not to look forward to the resurrection of the body, which will be flesh and spirit united in peace, the way they were in Christ. The resurrection of Christ seems the high point in the law of nature. Both O'Connor and Chesterton share the eye of a visual artist in using the written word. Flannery wrote, "I know a good many fiction writers who paint, not because they're any good at painting, but because it helps their writing. It forces them to look at things. Fiction writing is very seldom a matter of saying things. It is a matter of showing things." Another common attribute was the sense of humor. But not just the sense of humor, but their own appreciation of it. Chesterton, famous for laughing at his own jokes. O'Connor was very entertained by her own humor. Speaking of reading her stories in public, she said, "The funnier the story, the straighter the face it should be read with. And I am the kind who laughs heartily at my own jokes. This weekend, I read the first story in the book and disgraced myself in this fashion." To Robie McCauley, she wrote, "I certainly am glad you like the stories, because now I feel it's not so bad that I like them so much. The truth is, I like them better than anybody, and I read them over and over and laugh and laugh. Then get embarrassed when I remember I was the one who wrote them." I'd like to read you a longer piece from an unpublished fragment connected to one of her stories, because I doubt that many of you have seen it, and it's a good snapshot of O'Connor. Apparently, she had thoughts of expanding "The Life You Saved May Be Your Own" into a longer story, including this scene from Tom T. Shiflett's Youth. It includes a phrenologist. The phrenology, the pseudo-scientific fad that Chesterton skewered in one of his essays. Unfortunately, in his case, he also used it as an opportunity to defend Robespierre, but that's another debate. Mr. Shiflett felt that a man with an automobile had a responsibility that a man without one didn't. It was not a particular responsibility like using oil. He didn't use any oil. Or observing the traffic regulations. He didn't do that either. But it was something different. When he traveled on foot, he had been forced to observe closely everything he saw. But now that he had a car, he was free of that obligation. Where before he had seen a tree as a tree, now he saw a tree as a blur. And some things he had formerly seen, he wasn't obliged to see at all anymore. This was a very agreeable change to him. It meant that he could give his attention to larger and larger matters. Mr. Shiflett had known since he was 10 years old that he was a man with a particular destiny. One Saturday morning in his 10th year, when he was playing in his backyard, his mother had come to the kitchen door and called him into the house. She was a plump woman with the soft, melting eyes of a turkey hen and a constantly murmuring voice. "Oh, put on your Sunday suit and your shoes," she said. "Now wash your face and hands and come into the sitting room." "What for?" Mr. Shiflett asked. "Do like I tell you," she said, and hurried away. Mr. Shiflett was very much afraid it was going to be a missionary's wife, and he didn't hurry. His mother was grooming him to be a missionary, but he had already decided against it because he didn't want to marry a missionary's wife. He had not made up his mind what he was going to be. When he didn't appear in the parlor door after 10 minutes, his mother left the guest and went after him. Presently, she returned, pushing him in front of her. The sitting room was actually the hall. It contained an organ, a black settee, a cane-bottomed chair, and a piece of colorless linoleum on part of the floor. Mr. Shiflett was at first relieved to see that the visitor was not a missionary's wife, and then terrified by what he did see. Hunched on the settee was an eyeless old man in a brown tailcoat. His head was as naked as a vulture's and the same shape. His nose, long and thin and blue, overhung a scar which gapped in the middle to expose a gold and black tooth side by side. At his left, hanging on a wire stand, there was a colorful diagram of the human skull, showing like a map of some partially explored country, rivers leading into jungles and getting lost, mountains appearing and disappearing in strange circles that might have been volcanoes or patches of impenetrable swamp. At his right, there was a black bag such as a doctor carries, and his hand, large, red, and misshapen, rested on it, twitching slightly. After a second, Mr. Shiflett perceived a glinting movement in the depths of one of the old man's eye cavities, and he knew he was being watched. His mother's knee was prodding his behind insistently. "Thomas," she said, "let this gentleman feel your head." "I don't want him to feel my head," Mr. Shiflett murmured. "Dr. Sparks is a phrenologist," his mother said. "He's going to feel your head." Before Mr. Shiflett could begin to murmur, the big red hand leapt off the black bag and snatched him forward by the shirt front. He was gripped in the vise of two knees, and another red hand, identical, appeared from the other side and began to feel its way slowly over the surface of his skull. "He wants to be a missionary," his mother said. "He's a very good boy. Last year he joined the church. He's very good with numbers. How much is 7 times 8, Thomas?" "He can build, too. Last year he built the bird box with a chimney on it. He memorizes 5 Bible verses every day and plans to have the entire Bible by heart by the time he's 21. "Say a verse, Thomas," she said. "Any verse." Jesus wept. "Last winter," his mother continued, "there was ice in the pond, and all the children went down the slide, and the little boy went down. Thomas said, 'Have courage, little boy, and say some verses while I run and find a rope to pull you out with.' Then Thomas came running home and cut down the clothesline." While she went on with her account, the old man's fingers continued to explore, ascending every bump on Mr. Shiflett's skull as if it were a perilous mountain, and descending again on the other side, warily, as if any second one of them might be swallowed alive in some pit. On one bump, a finger got halfway up and then hastily back down again and went around. Mr. Shiflett turned his head ever so slightly and found himself looking directly into the two caves where he had first seen the glinty movement. At first he saw nothing. Then in the furthest reaches of each tunnel, he saw a small milky green eye shining with pure evil. With a wrench, he freed himself and shot out of the room. "Oh my goodness," his mother cried. The old man, who had shaken himself, held up his hand. "Madam," he said, "let him go. It's better he don't hear what I have to say to you." Mr. Shiflett had run no further than the next room, and these words, plainly heard, stopped him instantly. He made his way back to the closed door and pressed his ear to the crack. "What do you think of his character?" he heard his mother. "Madam," the old man began, "the soul is an extensive and uncharted garden that we have every indication exists, if it exists at all, under the bony container that we call the skull. We have every indication, madam," he said, "that there is something peculiar there which requires our attention. This is Shiflett's side. On the other hand, the old man continued, this is by no means proven, and science, madam, proceeds with extreme caution on unproven ground. So let me tell you at once that with equal authority, I can maintain the opposite of anything I say. Yes, Mrs. Shiflett said, but without a decided tone of interest in her voice, for this statement had really been too deep for her. But if, the old man continued, and there was a subtle change in his tone, if, madam, there is anything under the bony container that requires our attention, we know that it requires our attention because, he lowered his voice to a hum, it is pure, it is holy. It is sanctified by the breath of sweetness. Mrs. Shiflett said yes, more eagerly this time, for pure, good, holy, and sweet were her favorite words. And we would do nothing, madam, to upset the divine balance or to contaminate the holy atmosphere of the little mind that will find its way to truth by its own devices. For truth, he said, is a matter of time and place and continual adjustment. So far, Mr. Shiflett had not heard anything that interested him much. Madam, the old man said, had I been there to feel Napoleon's head, the course of history would be changed. Had I been there to feel Alexander the Great's head, how much greater he would have been. Madam, he said, and his voice trembled with emotion, had I been there to feel Jesus's head, he would never have died on the cross. Mr. Shiflett, like his mother, felt only that he was being favorably compared with Napoleon and Alexander and Jesus, and forgot to pity Jesus for not having Dr. Sparks to feel his head. Well, how must I bring him up? The poor widow asked. What must I make him do next? Make? The old man said in a shocked tone. Madam, he said, make him do nothing. Let him do what he pleases. I tremble for this boy, he said, if he is ever made to do anything. The conscience, he added inconsequently, must be sturdy and searching, and ever on the march, not simply keeping up with the world, but leading it to new heights. Let him do what he pleases, his mother murmured, stunned. Let him do what he pleases, the old man said, and he will do the right thing. Count upon it. Suppose he shouldn't want to wear his shoes on a cold, rainy day. Mrs. Shiflett asked, thinking of worse things. Madam, the old charlatan said, on a cold, rainy day, he will want to wear his shoes. That is my point. And Mr. Shiflett, pressed close to the door, could hear him rolling up his chart. Besides, he said in a haughty voice, my branch of science is the head, not the foot. I do not answer for anything below the neck. He said with dignity, I am greatly ahead of my time. Mr. Shiflett was not a foolhardy boy. Even at the age of 10, he was accustomed to give thought to his actions. He could have been called calculating had he not been so very innocent. Do you think, he heard his mother ask with a slightly uncontrolled voice, that he will be a great man? Madam, the old man said in magnificent tones, as regards the future, I am neither a prophet nor a spy. I am a humble scientist. I have told you what to do. I tremble lest you do it not. My fee, he added, is 50 cents. Neither Mr. Shiflett nor his mother realized that for 50 cents, they were getting information that in more advanced parts would have cost them a fortune. But both of them were greatly impressed. She, because she didn't understand a word of it. And her son, because pondering all these things in his heart, he felt that he could change the world. Both writers appreciated St. Thomas Aquinas. O'Connor was steeped in Aquinas. She read him for 20 minutes at night before bed. It comes through in her fiction and her approach to fiction. Like Chesterton, she appreciated Aquinas' contention that the beginning of human knowledge is through the senses. She said, the real novelist, the one with an instinct for what he is about, knows that he cannot approach the infinite directly, that he must penetrate the natural human world as it is. The more sacramental his theology, the more encouragement he will get to do just that. He also said, I don't write to bring anybody a message. That is not the purpose of the novelist. Again, drama usually bases itself on the bedrock of original sin. The novelist doesn't write about people in a vacuum. He writes about people in a world where something is obviously lacking, where there's a general mystery of incompleteness and a particular tragedy of our own times to be demonstrated. Part of the particular tragedy of our own times is the stifling atmosphere of nihilism. If you live today, you breathe in nihilism. It's the gas you breathe. If I hadn't the church to fight it with or to tell me the necessity of fighting it, I would be the stinkingest logical positivist you ever saw right now, she said. Nihilism, especially as preached by Nietzsche, was something opposed by Chesterton as a controversialist and a fiction writer. You find in O'Connor's fiction a string of nihilistic characters of various stripes, typically negating their way back to the cross, to use the words of Brainerd Cheney in his review of O'Connor's Wise Blood. It was Chesterton who said, the young man who rings the bell at the brothel is unconsciously looking for God. One of her nihilists was the misfit, who said of the grandmother, in A Good Man Is Hard to Find, she would have been a good woman if it had been somebody there to shoot her every minute of her life. Man alive, anybody? Innocent Smith was no nihilist, but his targets were. Flannery O'Connor said, I have found, in short, from reading my own writing, that my subject in fiction is the action of grace in territory largely held by the devil. Closely connected with the nihilistic tragedy of our own times is the enemy recognized by both writers. Chesterton said, against such an aching vacuum of joyless approval, there is only one antidote, a sudden and pugnacious belief in positive evil. This world can be made beautiful again by beholding it as a battlefield. When we have defined and isolated the evil thing, the colors come back into everything else. When evil things have become evil, good things in a blazing apocalypse become good. There are some men who are dreary because they do not believe in God. But there are many others who are dreary because they do not believe in the devil. When explaining her characters negating their way back to the cross, O'Connor said, in general, the devil can always be subject for my kind of comedy one way or another. I suppose this is because he is always accomplishing ends other than his own. More than the devil, I'm interested in the indication of grace. The moment you know, grace has been offered and accepted. She also said, my devil has a name, a history, and a definite plan. His name is Lucifer. He is a fallen angel. His sin is pride. And his aim is the destruction of the divine plan. For both Chesterton and O'Connor, dogma was a necessary antidote to the poisonous gas we breathe. Chesterton said, dogma is actually the only thing that cannot be separated from education. It is education. O'Connor said, dogma can in no way limit a limitless God. For to me, dogma is only a gateway to contemplation and is an instrument of freedom and not of restriction. It preserves mystery for the human mind. Chesterton said, dogma means the serious satisfaction of the mind. Dogma does not mean the absence of thought, but the end of thought. O'Connor upped the ante. Dogma is an instrument for penetrating reality. In the same spirit, Chesterton added, the spike of dogma fitted exactly into the hole in the world. And O'Connor, dogma is the guardian of mystery. The doctrines are spiritually significant in ways that we cannot fathom. Whenever O'Connor is discussed, the subject of the grotesque is not far behind. She said, even though the writer who produces grotesque fiction may not consider his characters any more freakish than an ordinary fallen man usually is, his audience is going to, and it is going to ask him, or more often tell him, why he has chosen to bring such maimed souls alive. Readers did ask, and continue to wonder, why she chose to bring such maimed souls alive. And I think we've touched on that in the discussion of nihilism. She used the grotesque as a means of exposing the human condition, in the words of Henry Edmondson. In her copy of Jacques Maritain's Intuition in Art and Poetry, O'Connor underlined the following: art draws beauty from ugly things and monsters. Her art did, and for good reason. We're all grotesque, she said, and added that her stories were grotesque because, quote, we suffered from original sin. It's a subject on which Chesterton also had some thoughts, such as, man is a monstrosity. I myself was at once worse and better than all things. O'Connor said, the novelist with Christian concerns will find in modern life distortions which are repugnant to him. And his problem will be to make these appear as distortions to an audience which is used to seeing them as natural. And he may well be forced to take ever more violent means to get his vision across to this hostile audience. When you can assume that your audience holds the same beliefs you do, you can relax a little and use more normal ways of talking to it. When you have to assume that it does not, then you have to make your vision apparent by shock. To the hard of hearing, you shout. And for the almost blind, you draw large and startling fake figures. She also said, the novelist must be characterized not by his function, but by his vision. And we must remember that his vision has to be transmitted, and that the limitations and blind spots of his audience will very definitely affect the way he is able to show what he sees. This is another thing which in these times increases the tendency toward the grotesque in fiction. I hate to think that in 20 years, Southern writers, too, may be writing about men in gray flannel suits, and they have lost their ability to see that these gentlemen are even greater freaks than we are writing about now. Chesterton, in response, the normal condition of man is not his sane and sensible condition. The normal is an abnormality. O'Connor said, and she was focused, really, on the incarnation. It's not a matter of these stories of do unto others. That can be found in any ethical culture series. It is the fact of the Word made flesh. As the Misfit said, he's thrown everything off balance, and it's nothing for you to do but follow him or find some meanness. That is the fulcrum that lifts my particular stories. I'm a Catholic, but this is in Orthodox Protestantism too, though out of context, which makes it grow into grotesque form. Catholic using his own eyes and the eyes of the church, when he's inclined to open them, is in the most favorable position to recognize the grotesque. One more from Chesterton. Present a matter in a grotesque manner does certainly tend to touch the nerve of surprise, and thus draw attention to the intrinsically miraculous character of the object itself. And lastly, from O'Connor. But our present grotesque characters are not comic, or at least not primarily so. They seem to carry an invisible burden and to fix us with eyes that remind us that we all bear some heavy responsibility whose nature we have forgotten. They are prophetic figures. In the novelist's case, prophecy is a matter of seeing near things with their extensions of meaning, and thus seeing far things close up. A prophet is a realist of distances, distances in the qualitative sense, and it is this kind of realism that you find in the best modern instances of the grotesque. Prophetic figures with, quote, eyes that remind us that we all bear some heavy responsibility whose nature we have forgotten. Reminds me that we are the survivors of a wreck, the crew of a golden ship that had gone down before the beginning of the world. In Catholic circles, there is a quote from O'Connor about the Eucharist, which is probably the most quoted line of hers. And I want to read you a little more from that letter that it came from to get a little bit of the context of it, because I think the whole thing is extremely good. This was when she was living in New York City. She would have been 24 years old, and she was the guest of her friends, I think it might have been the Fitzgeralds, at the apartment of Mary McCarthy, the writer. I was once, 5 or 6 years ago, taken by some friends to have dinner with Mary McCarthy and her husband, Mr. Broadwater. She departed the church at the age of 15 and is a big intellectual. We went at 8, and at 1, I hadn't opened my mouth once, there being nothing for me in such company to say. Having me there was like having a dog present who had been trained to say a few words, but overcome with inadequacy had forgotten them. Well, toward morning, the conversation turned on the Eucharist, which I, being the Catholic, was obviously supposed to defend. Mrs. Broadwater said, when she was a child and received the host, she thought of it as the Holy Ghost, he being the most portable person of the Trinity. Now she thought of it as a symbol and implied that it was a pretty good one. I then said, in a very shaky voice, well, if it's a symbol, to hell with it. That was all the defense I was capable of. I realize now that this is all I will ever be able to say about it, outside of the story, except that it is the center of existence for me. All the rest of life is expendable. Her introduction to the A Memoir of Mary Ann is really a great piece of, it's a great essay, which I recommend for all. I quoted from it in part before. There's another part which I think, for me, has a Chestertonian link. Most of us have learned to be dispassionate about evil, to look at it in the face and find, as often as not, our own grinning reflection, which with we do not argue. But good is another matter. Few have stared at that long enough to accept the fact that its face, too, is grotesque. That in us, the good is something under construction. The modes of evil usually receive worthy expression. The modes of good have to be satisfied with a cliché or a smoothing down that will soften their real look. When we look into the face of good, we are liable to see a face like Mary Ann's, full of promise. Let me close with one more quote from O'Connor. She was very fond of the quote that she will have within this quote of St. Cyril of Jerusalem, and I would guess Chesterton was too. St. Cyril of Jerusalem, in instructing the catechumens, wrote, "The dragon sits by the side of the road, watching those who pass. Beware lest he devour you. We go to the Father of Souls, but it is necessary to pass by the dragon." O'Connor said, "No matter what form the dragon may take, it is of this mysterious passage past him or into his jaws that stories of any depth will always be concerned to tell. And this being the case, it requires considerable courage at any time, in any country, not to turn away from the storyteller." Thank you.
Thank
Thank you, Mark. That was really good. We have some time for some questions, so please, if you have a couple of questions, we've got some time here. Mark is guaranteed to know the answer. Over there. Father Lutz.
Were there any books by D.K. Chesterton that Flannery O'Connor particularly read or influenced her or that she mentioned?
The question is, were there any books by Chesterton that O'Connor read and may have been influenced by? We don't know. In The Habit of Being, the published letters, there's one reference to Chesterton, and it's actually not to him, but an article written about him. And but I gotta believe that Man Alive was somewhere in The Misfit. Right? That line about always having a gun pointed at her was too close of a link.
Yeah.
Others? Question on sources that help us understand O'Connor. There actually are quite a few, and there are, seem to be a growing number. The interest in O'Connor is growing. Her comment about waiting 50 to 100 years to be understood is prophetic, I guess. But the one that I just recently discovered, which I think the parts of it that I've read, I haven't even finished it, is Return to Good and Evil by Henry Edmondson. And that's really a focus on that whole nihilistic thread that runs through her fiction. And I think he's very good. He actually is in Milledgeville. He's a college professor and had access to all of her papers. And as I said, what I read of it is very good. I would also recommend Ralph Wood's Flannery O'Connor and the Christ Haunted South. Passing by the Dragon, I think, is good, and I can't remember the author, but I'll get it for you. Lorraine Murray's book, The Abbess of Andalusia. Andalusia was the name of the farm outside of Milledgeville. Is definitely a good book, worth reading. Introduction by Joseph Pierce, where he makes a link in that between the misfit in A Good Man is Hard to Find and the man who was thirsty. So pick it up to find out what he sees as the link there.
Question here.
I read somewhere, it might have been in her letters, that she said that all her stories were about people having a moment of grace where they had to make a decision. Could you comment on that?
Yes, the question is, you know, her comments around the moment of grace in her fiction. And you know, as she said there in that talk about the devil, she said, more than the devil, I'm concerned about the offer of grace. And there, if you look at her fiction, there are moments that you can pick out. Sometimes it requires a second reading or more that, you know, strike you again as you review them, that was a moment of grace. Certainly in A Good Man is Hard to Find, she was very clear about saying that the moment of grace for the grandmother came when she recognized the misfit, this horrible murderer, as one of her own children, and reached out to embrace him, which cost her life. And she said of that moment, the moment of grace always excites the devil to a frenzy. And it did. But that was a comedy in the sense of her dying in the state of grace. And she made that clear as she described the position and the look of the grandmother in death. And even said afterwards that she felt that about the character of the misfit, that could have been a seed planted in him that later may have led to him becoming the prophet he was meant to be. That was her words, not mine. But yeah, most of those stories do contain something. It's not always accepted. Tom T. Shiflett didn't, and like you say, would be your own.
One interesting comment, in fact, it was Father Ian Boyd of the Chester Review said that for him, the Flannery O'Connor stories are the real action begins after the story is over. That's when the real story happens, and all you're reading is the setup, and then you have to really imagine. That's when the artistic work of the reader is done, the active participation to what happened after that story is over. That's a very interesting comment. We got time for one more question. Right there, Lori.
Isn't there a sense in which, I just recently have begun to engage with Flannery O'Connor, and you know, I read reviews about her, about the grotesque, but in the world we live in, is her grotesque as it used to seem? You know, when someone can drive a what-ton truck down on Bastille Day and run over children, you know, that's, you know, we live in a grotesque world. So is there a sense in which readers today of Flannery are seeing her a little different from your point of view?
The question is, are people a little more able to handle the violence and the grotesque that's in O'Connor in a world that has become more violent and more grotesque? I don't know. They still seem to have problems with her.
Yeah.
and I think, you know, the act of reading, you know, engages you in such a way that it's still a shock when some of these things happen. And you are engaged when you're reading in
right.
a way that you're not in hearing the news.
Right.
But the other thing that she wanted to get at, you know, the comment about the man in the gray flannel shirt suit being more of a freak, part of her focus also was on the smog and on the people who think they stand when really they don't. And, you know, one of her characters in the story Greenleaf, quote from memory was, she considered herself a good Christian woman, though she didn't believe a word of it. and that's really a capsule.
Yeah.
You know, another one that I didn't get, I thought really wouldn't fit, but I wanted to quote, Mrs. Hopewell, I don't know if you're thinking of Mrs. Hopewell had no faults of her own, but she was able to use others in such a creative fashion that she never felt the lack. That's a kind of character.
One more book I'd recommend for those who just want a one-volume introduction to Flannery O'Connor, which is a combination of both fiction and nonfiction, which is a book that was very helpful to me, is The Spiritual Writings of Flannery O'Connor. And I can tell you that there are no Flannery O'Connor books here at the conference from any of our vendors, okay? So don't be looking for them. But buy some Chesterton books. Yeah, we have plenty of those. Mark, thank you very much. If all of the people who are on the Rome Pilgrimage can come up here for a photograph afterwards, that would be great. And I just want to remind everyone, the Clara Hughes are due right after lunch at 1 p.m., right at the beginning of the distributors panel this afternoon. We will start on time at 1 p.m., and we will stay on time. You watch. See you back at 1 o'clock. God bless.